Well, like I said, welcome to Eastern Nazarene College. We're very glad that you're here. My name is Professor Montague Williams. I serve as the chaplain and chair of the Division of Religion and Philosophy. And I just wanted to take a quick moment and just share a little bit with you about ENC and the Division of Religion and Philosophy. I do know that some of you, well, most of you are very familiar with the campus. Some of you drove down from quite a few miles away, and some of you may have heard about this event through the Patriot Ledger. And so I just want to just take a moment and just say that Eastern Nazarene College is a Christian college that is committed to the community, committed to thinking deeply about Christian faith, but also in light of what's going on in the world. And so we are a liberal arts college, and we are also one of the most racially and culturally diverse Christian colleges in the country, and we're proud to be intentional about that. The Division of Religion and Philosophy has a particular threefold model of how we do things. We seek to cultivate a culture of contextual ecclesial leadership, authentic Christian community, and rigorous theological scholarship. And we do that through a variety of things, and this lecture tonight is an example of that. And I just wanted to take a moment and just say, we're glad you're here. And you know, the way we do theology influences the way we pray, and the way we pray influences the way we do theology. And so before Dr. Phil LaFountain comes forward and tells us about the Gould lecture series, and then introduces our lecture, I just thought we'd take a moment and pray. Dear God, thank you so much for knowing us and for loving us. Thank you for letting us be a part of your mission in the world. God, we thank you for calling us to love you with all of ourselves, with our hearts, our minds, our strength, our bodies. God, we pray that tonight, through this lecture and through the dialogue, that you would form us and shape us into the people you call us to be. We pray that we wouldn't do this alone, but with your presence, your active presence. We pray this in your name and for the sake of your kingdom. Amen.
Well, I'll have to admit, I'm a bit giddy with excitement tonight having being able to welcome you to this 2016-2017 Gould Lecture Series with Dr. Stanley Hauerwas. Before we begin, let me first offer my appreciation for those involved in the planning and shaping of the lecture. Thanks to Eastern Nazarene College, of course, Dr. Colas McGee and Provost Dr. Tim Worcester for cultivating an atmosphere in which something like this could take place. And thanks to Reverend Stretch Dean, pastor of Wollaston Church of the Nazarene, and his wonderful team for facilitating and supporting this event, and for allowing us to utilize these beautiful facilities. And I especially appreciate Pastor Dean's deep care and fervor for the spiritual well-being of students at Eastern Nazarene College. Thank you, Pastor. And I want to thank my colleagues in the Religion Department, Dr. William Malice, Chaplain Montague Williams, of course, Professor David Restrick, and Professor Julian Tegerstrand, a vibrant and very enticing group as we think theologically together, but also Andrea Sautel, Pastor Matt Thomas, and Pastor Jeremy Scott, who function with us and enable us to offer the array of courses that we're able to do so in the department. And I'm especially pleased to acknowledge the collaboration between the college, the Religion Department, the Spiritual Development Office, and the New England District of the Church of the Nazarene, especially to our District Superintendent, Reverend Ken Stanford, for his enthusiastic support of the college and this lecture in particular, and I'm grateful for that. It's good for us to work together in the kingdom, and I'm glad that we can work together in this lecture. And thanks to Reverend Jeremy Scott and Reverend Jerry Whetstone for supporting and promoting the lecture via social media. Tech gurus in their own right, to be sure. And for Lauren Bowen for enabling us to video record the event and for the sound. And thanks to all who helped to set up downstairs and prepare for the lecture. So following Dr. Hauerwas' lecture this evening, we will take a short break and moved downstairs to the Metcalf Gathering Room for refreshments, provided for us by the New England District of the Church of Nazarene, followed by a question and answer time with Dr. Hauerwas. So if you have, through the lecture, something comes to your mind, you want to ask a question, follow-up question, you want to write that down or keep track of that, and we'll give you an opportunity downstairs to ask your question. Let me also remind you that tomorrow, Tuesday, February 7th, from noon to 1:15, we'll have a panel discussion in the Metcalf Gathering Room just downstairs by the Religion Department, but moderated by ENC student Chris Estep. Dr. Hauerwas, of course, will not be there. He's giving another lecture tomorrow at Emerson College, so we're able to piggyback with Emerson College. The Gould Holiness Lectures on Holiness offer the Eastern Nazarene College community the opportunity to hear outstanding Wesleyan scholars discuss aspects of the Christian doctrine of holiness. Dr. J. Glenn Gould began the lectures in 1945 in memory of his parents and the Reverend and Mrs. John Gould. The inaugural lecture was published in a book entitled The Whole Counsel of God. The Reverend John Gould served Eastern Nazarene College from 1925 to 1928 as chairman of the Board of Trustees and business manager before being elected as district superintendent of the New England District. Mrs. Gould served as Dean of Women for the college during the same time period. Following Dr. Gould's passing, his daughter and son-in-law, Winifred, and the late Harold Jones continue to sponsor the series in loving memory of their grandparents and the Reverend and Mrs. John Gould, parents, and Dr. and Mrs. J. Glenn Gould. So here's my question tonight. Why Stanley Hauerwas? Why invite this particular theologian to engage Nazarenes and our extended family and friends at this particular time? Let me contextualize that, because we invited Dr. Hauerwas to come to share what was on his heart and mind and the work that he's doing regarding holiness in his research. But in order to contextualize that, let me say a few words before he comes. The 19th century holiness theology, deeply influenced by Phoebe Palmer's so-called altar theology, embedded in the theological imagination of the Church of the Nazarene at its inception, began to face serious questions of plausibility by the mid-1970s and began to unravel in the decades following, culminating in its demise by the early 1990s, if not earlier than that. The theological and practical vacuum left in its absence was partially filled by the rather radical critique of the 19th century holiness model in the neo-Wesleyan reformulation initiated by Mildred Banks Wynkoop in her Theology of Love, emphasizing the credibility gap manifest in the life and practice of Nazarenes and the continuation of that trajectory in the work of H. Ray Dunning, especially as he frames holiness and sanctification in the ontology of relation, which tried to fill the theological vacuum by the loss of our inherited and original theological vision. Today, the neo-Wesleyan relational holiness theology, while primarily an expression of holiness among the baby boomers of our denomination, still enjoys some measure of prominence. Yet I would argue its social influence is waning following its peak in the 80s and 90s of the previous millennium. Our situation today as a holiness denomination is rather ambiguous. We still believe in holiness, that is, it's still a central feature of our official theology and is codified in our manual, but it has unfortunately little social impact on the formation of particular holiness identities in our local congregations. That is, we still believe in holiness and sanctification and certainly pay lip service to it, but we are not quite sure anymore what that holy life might look like, and we certainly are not sure exactly how to get there. This skepticism grows deeper and deeper, all the while a theological vacuum continues in our denomination. So we could ask the question, what is filling that vacuum? Well, we are producing really good generic evangelicals in our local churches for whom an American liberal democracy and a rational capitalism is the ultimate manifestation of the kingdom of God in the world, a true expression of the freedom God wishes us to have and for which Jesus died. And oh, by the way, you also get to go to heaven afterwards and give Jesus a big hug. I first became acquainted with Stanley Hauerwas' work at Nazarene Theological Seminary when I read his Community of Character toward a constructive Christian social ethic. Yet I later learned that that book emerges out of his earlier work in Vision and Virtue, Essays in Christian Ethical Reflection, in which Stanley tries to orient or reorient the field of ethics, at least in the American scene, along the lines of character and virtue, in which he imagines an ethic of character, and at the heart is the image of the self or agent as a storied identity. The social context for this work appears to me to be a critique of situation ethics. In a closely related work, Character and Christian Life, a Study in Theological Ethics, I take Stanley to be relating these rather more philosophical notions and placing them in dialogue with explicitly Christian theological notions of holiness and sanctification, something that I think in later work he returns to. Thus, he reimagines holiness or sanctification as an ethics of character, a vision in which the actions of a person are powerfully informed by his or her prior experience and nurture. Character then provides the means to frame the relation between Christ and the moral life. And yet the question arises, where do these identities, these characters, emerge? What is the social location or social process that informs and shapes these persons of Christian character? Hauerwas' answer, of course, is the ecclesia, the church as a mediation of the kingdom of God. This is where community of character comes in. If the human agent, the self, is a storied identity, then the church also is storied. And the church's story is Jesus of Nazareth, who is the Christ. The church is then a story-formed community, a polis-like social reality that shapes and forms Christian identity. The church then is a polity, and every polity produces a certain kind of person so that you can judge a polity by the kind of person it produces. Now, the church does not exist in a vacuum. It is the body of Christ in the world, and the church is found in varying forms of social context. In America, it happens to be in the context of a liberal democracy, which is itself a polity. What then is the relationship between the church, and here I reference primarily my own tribe, the Church of the Nazarene, and its cultural and social context? The model of the relationship between the church and democracy, secular forms of it, is the chaplaincy model. That is, the church functions in a subordinate way to reinforce and affirm secular polity. The role the church plays is to ratify the decisions and actions of just such a democracy. So how do we challenge what is now the default relationship in America between church and society? I think this is what Stanley was trying to do in Resident Aliens, a provocative Christian assessment of culture and ministry for people who know that something is wrong. Well, I'm not certain there are a lot of people who know that something's wrong. But I think that's a great subtitle, a book that he wrote with William Willimon. The chaplain model for the kingdom and for the church is an utter failure. So the question emerges, is there an alternative relationship? Can we imagine such an alternative? Does the church have the imagination to live faithfully into the kingdom of God as the church, its own social reality? A little context before Stanley Hauerwas comes to speak. Stanley Hauerwas is the Gilbert T. Rowe Professor Emeritus of Divinity and Law at the Divinity School at Duke University in Durham, North Carolina. He has written a voluminous number of articles, authored and edited many books, and has been the subject of other theologians' writings and interest. He has been a board member of the Society of Christian Ethics associate editor of a number of Christian journals and periodicals, and a frequent lecturer at campuses across the country. Would you join me in welcoming Dr. Stanley Hauerwas as he comes to give our Gould lecture series tonight? Thank you.
Thank you, Philip. That was wonderful. That was such a wonderful account of what I think. I'm afraid to say anything more. Thank you so much for that contextualization, Philip. I also need to say I understand where I am. I'm a Dallas Cowboy fan. I was raised in Pleasant Grove, Texas. I went to sleep last night thinking Atlanta was going to win, so there you are. Proves I'm a kind of atheist here. I'm a Christian. I'm even a Christian theologian. I observe in my memoir, Hannah's Child, that you do not need to be a theologian to be a Christian, but I probably did. Being a Christian has not and does not come naturally or easy for me. I take that to be a good thing, because I'm sure that to be a Christian requires training that lasts a lifetime. I am more than ready to acknowledge that some may find being a Christian comes more naturally, but that can present its own difficulties. Just as an athlete with natural gifts may fail to develop the fundamental skills necessary to play their sport after their talent fades, so people naturally disposed to faith may fail to develop the skills necessary to sustain it for a lifetime. By training, I mean something very basic, such as acquiring habits of speech necessary for prayer. The acquisition of such habits is crucial for the formation of our bodies if we're to acquire the virtues necessary to live as a Christian. For I take it to be crucial that Christians must live in a manner that their lives are unintelligible if the God we worship in Jesus Christ does not exist. The training entailed in being a Christian can be called, if you're so disposed, a culture. That is particularly the case if Raymond Williams, as Raymond Williams reminds us in his key words, culture is a term first used as a process noun to describe the tending or cultivation of a crop or an animal. One of the challenges Christians confront is how the politics we created has made it difficult to sustain the material practices constitutive of an ecclesial culture to produce Christians. The character of much of modern theology exemplifies the development in the attempts to make Christianity intelligible within the epistemological conceits of modernity. Theologians have been intent on showing that what we believe as Christians is not that different than what those who are not Christians believe. Thus, McIntyre's wry observation that the project of modern theology to distinguish the kernel of Christian faith from the outmoded husk has resulted in offering atheists less and less in which to disbelieve. It should not be surprising, as David Yago argues, that many secular people now assume that descriptions of reality that Christians employ are a sort of varnish that can be scraped away to reveal a more basic account of what has always been the case. From a secular point of view, it is assumed that we agree or should agree on fundamental naturalistic and secular descriptions of reality, whatever religious elaborations may be lay over them. What I find interesting is that many Christians accept these naturalistic assumptions about the way things are because they believe by doing so it's possible to transcend our diverse particularities that otherwise results in unwelcome conflict. From such a perspective, it is only a short step to the key socio-political move crucial to the formation of modern societies, that is, the relegation of religion to the sphere of the private inwardness and individual motivation. Societies that have relegated strong convictions to the private, a development I think appropriately called secularization, may assume a tolerant or intolerant attitude toward the church, but the crucial characteristic of such societies is the church is understood to be no more than a voluntary association of like-minded individuals. Even those who identify as religious assume their religious convictions should be submitted to a public order governed by a secular rationality. I hope to challenge that assumption by calling into question the conceptual resources that now seem to be given for how the church is understood. I hope to convince Christians that the church is a material reality that must resist the domestication of our faith in the interest of societal peace. There's a great deal going on going against such a project. For example, in his book, Civil Religion, A Dialogue in the History of Political Philosophy, Ron Biner argues that in modernity, the attempt to domesticate strong religious convictions in the interest of state control has assumed two primary and antithetical alternatives, civil religion and our liberalism. Civil religion, that is what Rousseau tried, is the attempt to empower religion not for the good of religion, but for the creation of something called the citizen. Indeed, the very creation of religion as a concept more fundamental than a determinative tradition is a manifestation that, at least in Western societies, Christianity had to become civil. Rousseau is the decisive figure that gave expression for this transformation, because Rousseau saw clearly that the modern state could not risk having a church capable of challenging its political authority. In the process, the political concepts used to legitimate the modern state, at least if Carl Schmitt is right, are secularized theological concepts. In contrast to the civil religion alternative, the liberal respects all attempts to use religion to produce citizens in service to the state. Liberalism, in its many versions, according to Biner, seeks to domesticate or neutralize the impact of religious commitment on political life. Liberalism may well result in the production of a banal and flattened account of human existence, but such a form of life seems necessary if we are to be at peace with one another. In other words, liberalism as a way of life depends on the creation of a people who think there's nothing for which it is worth dying other than any attempt to escape dying. President Bush, who suggested that the duty of Americans after September the 11th, 2001, was to go shopping, exemplifies this attitude. Such a view of the world evokes Nietzsche's bitter condemnation, ironically making Nietzsche an ally of Christianity, who said, as soon as you get Christians talking about values, you can be sure they are atheists. An extraordinary claim to be sure, but as Paul Kahn has observed, the Western state exists, quote, under the very real threat of Christian martyrdom, a threat to expose the state and its claims to power as nothing at all. The martyr does so, according to Kahn, because when everything is said and done, sacrifice is always stronger than murder. The martyr wields a power that defeats the murderer because the martyr can be remembered by a community more enduring than the state. That is why the liberal state has such a stake in the domestication of Christianity by making it a lifestyle choice, and who would be willing to die for that? In contrast, the modern nation state, Kahn argues, has been an extremely effective sacrificial agent, able to mobilize its populations to make sacrifices to sustain its existence as an end in itself. The nation state, therefore, has stepped into the place of religious belief, offering the individual the possibility of transcending our finitude by dying for the state. War becomes the act of sacrifice by which the state sustains the assumption that though we die, it can and will continue to exist without end, making it the necessary agent of memory. I have earned the description of being a fideistic, sectarian, tribalist because of my attempt to imagine an ecclesial alternative capable of resisting the politics Biner describes. For as Yago observes, most churches in the West, with the possible exception of the Roman Catholics, have acquiesced in the understanding of the social character and have thereby collaborated in the eclipse of its ecclesial reality. As a result, the church seems caught in a ceaseless crisis of legitimation, in which the church must find a justification for its existence in terms of the projects and aspirations of the larger order. In his extraordinary book, Atheist Illusions, The Christian Revolution and Its Fashionable Enemies, David Bentley Hart observes that the relegation of the Christian beliefs to the private sphere is legitimated by a story of human freedom in which humankind is liberated from the crushing weight of tradition and doctrine. Hart, whose prose begs for an extensive quotation, says the story goes like this. Once upon a time, Western humanity was cosseted in an incurious ward of Mother Church. During this, the age of faith, culture stagnated, science languished, wars of religion were routinely waged, witches were burned by inquisitors, and Western humanity labored in the brutish subjugation to dogma, superstition, and the unholy alliance of church and state. Withering blast of fanaticism and fideism has long since scorched away the last remnants of classical learning. Inquiry was stifled. The literary remains of classical antiquity had long ago been consigned to the fires of faith, and even the great achievements of Greek science were forgotten until Islamic civilization restored them in the West. All was darkness. Then, in the wake of the wars of religion that had torn Christendom apart, came the full flowering of the Enlightenment, and with it the reign of reason and progress, the riches of scientific achievement and political liberty, and a new and revolutionary sense of human dignity was established. The secular nation-state arose, reduced religion to an establishment of the state, and thereby rescued Western humanity from the blood-steeped intolerance of religion. Now, at last, Western humanity has left its donage and attained its majority in science, politics, and ethics. The story of the travails of Galileo almost invariably occupies an honored place in this narrative as exemplary of the natural relation between faith and reason, as an exquisite epitome of the scientific reason's mighty struggle against the early modern period to free itself from the tyranny of religion. Doesn't that sound like what you learned in high school? Isn't that the story that we all picked up? The simple and enchanting tale is, Hart observes, captivating in its extraordinary power. According to Hart, however, there's just one problem with this story. The problem is that every detail of the story, as well as the overarching plot, just happens to be false. Hart's book provides the argument and evidence to sustain that judgment. What I find so interesting, however, is even if the narrative may be false in every detail, it is nonetheless true that believer and unbeliever alike assume, though they may disagree about some of the details, that the main plot of the story is true. Just think about the Dark Ages. What made them dark? This story now has canonical status has deep significance for how Christians should understand the relationship between faith and politics. Put even more strongly, in the interest of being good citizens, of being civil, Christians have lost the ability to say why what they believe is true. That loss is, I want to suggest, a correlative of the depoliticization of the church as a community capable of challenging the imperial pretensions of the modern state. Thus, the church matters is why I resist using the language of belief to indicate what allegedly makes Christians Christians. Of course, Christians believe in God. But far more important for determining the character of Christian existence is that it is constituted by a politics that cannot avoid challenging what is normally identified as the political. For what is normally identified as the political produces dualism that invites questions such as, what is the relation between faith and politics? If I am right that "and" prematurely ends any serious theological reflection from a Christian perspective. As I have already indicated, to make this argument necessarily puts me at odds with the attempt to make Christian convictions compatible with the epistemological and moral presuppositions of liberal social orders. That project presumed a story very much along the lines suggested by Hart. It produces people that say things like, "I believe Jesus is Lord, but that's just my personal opinion." I mean, what produces people that are as superficial as that? That project, as I say, assumed a story very much like the one Hart suggested. Theologians trimmed the sails of Christian convictions to show that even if the metaphysical commitments that seem intrinsic to Christian practice cannot be intellectually sustained, it remains the case that Christianity can claim some credit for the creation of cultures and politics of modernity. In particular, Christian theologians sought to justify Christian participation in politics of democratic societies. The field of Christian ethics, the discipline with which I'm identified, had one of its primary agendas, to convince Christians that their beliefs have political implications. The determinative representative who exemplified this mode of Christian ethical reflection was Reinhold Niebuhr. Thus his claim that, quote, "the real problem of a Christian social ethics is to derive from the gospel a clear view of the realities from which we must deal in our common or social life, and also to preserve a sense of responsibility for achieving the highest measure of order, freedom, justice, despite the hazards of man's collective life." The hazards of man's collective life, of course, Niebuhr meant, when all is said and done, you're going to have to kill someone for justice. Niebuhr reminded Christians that we do not live in a world which sin can be eliminated, but we nonetheless must seek to establish the tentative harmonies and provisional equities possible in any historical situation. Nietzsche, who prided himself for being a sober realist, challenging what he took to be the unfounded optimism, founded optimism of liberal thinkers such as John Dewey, would have in like manner called into question the optimism of the story Hart associates with the celebration, if not the legitimation, of modernity. But Niebuhr's support of liberal democratic political arrangements drew on a narrative very much like the one Hart identifies as the story of modernity. The result is ironic, a category Niebuhr loved, because Niebuhr's arguments for the political engagement by Christians presupposed a narrative that legitimated political arrangements that required the privatization of Christian convictions. One of the consequences being the loss of any attempt to say what it might mean for the gospel of Jesus Christ to be true. For instance, one of the curiosities associated with what has popularly been called the new atheist is their assumption that the most decisive challenge to the truthfulness of Christian convictions comes from the development in the sciences, or perhaps more accurately put, the methods of the sciences. Such a view fails to appreciate that the most decisive challenge to the truthfulness of Christian convictions is political. The politics of modernity has so successfully made Christianity but another lifestyle option, it is a mystery why the new atheists think it important to show what Christians believe to be false. Such a project hardly seems necessary, given that Christians, in the name of being good democratic citizens, now live lives of unacknowledged but desperate unbelief, just to the extent they believe that what they believe as a Christian cannot be true. As a result, Christians no longer believe that the church is an alternative politics to the politics of the world, which means they have lost any way to account for why Christians in the past thought they had a faith worth dying for. I need an example of what the connection between the truthfulness of Christian speech and politics might look like. An example is necessary because I'm not sure we know what Christianity so understood would look like. I think, however, we have the beginnings in the work of Karl Barth. Barth, more than any theologian in modernity, recognized that the recovery of the faith entailed a politics at odds with the world as we know it. For Barth, there is no kernel of the Christian faith because it begins and ends with the extraordinary claim that what we mean when we say God is determined by Mary's willingness to be impregnated by the Holy Spirit. That is not where Barth began, of course. Barth began presuming that the work of Protestant liberal theologians was a given. It was, however, a political event that called into question Barth's liberalism. On a day in early August of 1914, Barth read a proclamation in support of the war policy of Wilhelm II, signed by 93 German intellectuals. To Barth's horror, almost all of his venerated theological teachers were among the names of those who had signed in support of the war. Barth confesses he suddenly realized that he could no longer follow their theology or ethics. At that moment, the theology of the 19th century, the theology of Protestant liberalism, came to an end for Barth. Barth characterized the theology he thought must be left behind, a theology identified by figures such as Schleiermacher and Trelch, as the attempt to respond to the modern age by underwriting the assumption that Christianity is but an expression of the alleged innate human capacities for the infinite. From such a perspective, Christianity is understood to be but one particular expression of something called religion. Such a view of the Christian faith presumed that the primary task of Christian theology is to assure the general acceptance of the Christian faith for the sustaining of the achievements of Western civilization. Barth observed theology so conceived was more interested in man's relationship with God than God's dealings with us. For Barth, however, theology understood as the realization in one form or another of human self-awareness could have no ground or content other than ourselves. Faith as the Christian commerce with God could first and last be only a Christian commerce with themselves, Barth says. The figure haunting such an account of Christianity is, of course, Ludwig Feuerbach, who Barth thought had powerfully reconfigured the Christian faith as a statement of profound human needs and desires rather than God. Drawing on Kierkegaard, Dostoevsky, and Overbeck, as well as his discovery of what he characterized as the strange new world of the Bible, against the theology of his teachers, Barth proclaimed, "God is God." Barth did not think such a claim to be redundant, but rather to be the best expression of who God is. It is a response to the particularity of a God who has initiated an encounter with humankind, Barth says, that the stone wall we first ran up against was that the theme of the Bible is the deity of God. More exactly, God's deity, God's independence and particular character, not only in relation to the natural, but also to the spiritual cosmos. God's absolute unique existence, might, and initiative, above all, his relation to the human. For Barth, it was never a question, does God exist, but do we? So Barth challenged what he characterized as the accommodated theology of Protestant liberalism, using expressions such as God is holy other, who breaks in upon us perpendicularly from above. There is an infinite qualitative distinction between God and us, rendering any presumption that we can know God on our terms to be just that, namely presumption. Thus Barth's sobering claim that God is God and we are not means that it can never be the case we have the means to know God unless God makes himself first known to us. Barth will later acknowledge that his initial reaction against Protestant liberal theology may have been exaggerated, but any theology committed to clearing the grounds for a fresh expression of the Christian faith could not help but sound extreme. Barth acknowledged that his first salvos against Protestant liberalism seem to be saying that God is everything and the human nothing. Such a God, the God that is wholly other, isolated and set over against man, threatens to become the God of the philosophers rather than the God who called Abraham. The majesty of the God of the philosophers might have contradictory results of confirming the hopelessness of all human activity, Barthes said, but for Barthes wanted neither of these results. In retrospect, Barthes confesses he was wrongly exact where he was right, but at the time he did not know how to carry through with sufficient care the discovery of God's deity. For Barthes, the decisive breakthrough came with the recognition that God is what he is in his deity. He proves and reveals not in a vacuum as a divine being for himself, but precisely and authentically in the fact that he exists, speaks, and acts as the partner of the human, though of course the absolute superior partner. In short, Barthes discovered that it is precisely God's deity which includes and constitutes God's humanity found in Christ Jesus. We are not dealing with an abstract God, that is a God whose deity exists separated from man, because in Jesus Christ there can be no isolation of the human from God or God from the human. In Barthes' language, God's deity in Jesus Christ consists in the fact that God himself in him is the subject who speaks and acts with sovereignty. In Jesus Christ, man's freedom is wholly enclosed in the freedom of God. Without the condensation of God, there would be no exaltation of the human. We have no universal deity capable of being reached conceptually, but this concrete deity, real and recognizable, in the descent grounded in what sequence and particular the existence of Jesus Christ. I'm aware that this all-too-brief account of Barthes' decisive theological turn may seem but a report on esoteric methodological issues in Christian theology. But I ask you to remember that Barthes' discovery of the otherness of God, as the otherness intrinsic to God's humanity, was occasioned by his recognition of the failure of the politics and ethics of modern theology in the face of World War I. I think it's not accidental, moreover, that Barthes was among the first to recognize that the character of the politics represented by Hitler, Barthes was a person of unusual insight. He was a person of extraordinary vitality who was profoundly a political animal. But his perception of the threat of the Nazis represented cannot be separated from the theological turn occasioned by his reaction against his teachers who supported the war. Tim Gorringe has rightly argued in his book, Karl Barthes Against Hegemony, that Barthes never assumed his theology might have political implications because he assumed his theology was a politics. That way of putting the matter, that is, theology was a politics, is crucial. The very structure of Barthes' dogmatics, with its integration of theology and ethics, displayed in his refusal to separate law from gospel, was Barthes' way of refusing any distinction between theory and practice. Barthes' Christocentrism meant that his theology was never a predicate of his politics, but also true that his politics is never a predicate of his theology. Gorringe's argument that Barthes was a political theologian was confirmed in 1934. The same year that Barthes wrote the Barman Declaration. That was a response to the challenge of some Americans and English critics that his theology was too abstract and unrelated to actual lives. Barthes begins his defense in Barman by observing that he is, after all, a modern man who stands in the midst of his age. Like his questioners that worry about whether he's too God-centered, He too must live a life not merely in theory, but in practice, in what he characterized as the stormy presence. Remember, 1934. Accordingly, he tells his antagonist that exactly because I was called to live in the modern world, that I reached the path which you have heard me speak. In particular, part calls attention to his years as a pastor when he faced the task of preaching the gospel in the face of secularism. During this time, he was confronted with the modern world, but he was also confronted with the modern church. It was a church, he says, a church of great sincerity and zeal, with fervent devotion to deeds of charity, too closely related to the modern world. It was a church that no longer knew God's choice to love the world by what Christians have been given to do in the light of that love, that is, to be witnesses to the treasure that is the gospel. The problem, according to Barth, is the church of the pious man, the church of the good person, this church of the moral person, is the church of the human. The result is the fusion of Christianity and nationalism. Consequently, the modern church is a near relative, according to Barth, to the godless modern world. If you want to know where secularism is, it's in our souls. That era, Barth suggests, began 200 years before the present with Prussia's, with Pietism's objections to orthodoxy. In the Reformation, the church heard of God and of Christ, but love was not active. The fatal error was the Christian response. They did not say, let God be even more God and Christ be even more Christ, but instead they said, let us improve matters. Reverence for the pious person became reverence for the moral person. And finally, when it was found that a person is of so large of importance, it became less important to speak of God, of Christ, of the Holy Spirit, and instead you begin to speak of human reason. Barth then directly addressed the questioners who accused him of being too God-centered, who he identifies as friends, to tell them he's well aware of what is happening, and that is exactly why he insists that he must speak of God. He must speak of God because he must begin with the confession, I am from Germany. Because he's from Germany, he knows that he stands in a place that has reached the end of a road. A road that he acknowledges may be just beginning, in social orders like America and England. Yet Barth claims he is sure that what he has experienced in Germany, that is, the remarkable apostasy of the church to nationalism, will also be the fate of those who think Barth's theology to be a retreat from political engagement. Thus, Barth challenges to his critics, if you make a start with God and something, you are opening the door to every demon. Barth early recognized such a demon had been let loose with Hitler. He was able to do so because Hitler's attempt to make Christianity a state religion by creating the German church meant that the free preaching of the gospel was prohibited. Theological speech and politics were inseparable. It is therefore no accident that Barth, in the Barman Declaration, challenged the German Christians on Christological grounds. He does so because Barth assumes that Jesus' claim, I am the way and the truth and the life, no one comes to the Father but by me, is the defining politics of Christianity. Barth wrote, Jesus Christ, as he is attested to us in Holy Scripture, is the one word of God, which we have to hear and which we have to trust and obey in life and in death. We reject the false doctrine as though the church could and would have to acknowledge as a source of its proclamation, apart from and besides the one word of God, still other events and powers, figures and truths, as God's revelation. The witness that is Karl Barth, that is how such a life lifts, how such a life fits into an ongoing story, we must tell as Christians of our faithful and unfaithful living of the gospel, means there's no way we can avoid making clear to ourselves and to the world that we believe a new world began in the conception of Jesus Christ in Mary's belly. Now you may rightly be wondering, if not worried, where has all this gotten you? I should like to be able to say more about where we are now and where we need to go, but I'm sure who the we or the us may be. I've always said I represent the Tonto principle of Christian ethics. The Tonto and the Lone Ranger found themselves surrounded by 20,000 Sioux in the Dakota. And the Lone Ranger looked over to the Tonto and said, this looks pretty tough, Tonto. What do you think we ought to do? Tonto said, "What do you mean, we white man?" I'm trying to help we Christians recover who the we is. I have assumed I should, or perhaps more truthfully, I can only speak from a first-person perspective, but hopefully it is one shaped by my Christian identity. Yet just as Bart confessed that he was German, so I and you must acknowledge we are Americans. Indeed, it may be I am more American than Christian, and thus tempted to confuse the Christian we with the American we. That confusion tempts Americans to assume we represent what any right-thinking person should say, because the we that we represent is the we that anyone would want to be if they had our education and money. American presumption is always a problem, but the problem is deeper than my American identity. For I think none of us can assume an agreed-upon we or us to be a manifestation of the cultural and political challenges that we face. Given the difficulty of locating the we, some may worry that the direct attention to Bart in order to show the political character of Christian convictions is morally and politically the exemplification of a profoundly reactionary position. In Nazi Germany, a Barman declaration may have seemed prophetic, but after Hitler, a Barman-like account of the politics of Christian convictions may suggest theocracy. I confess I often enjoy making liberal friends, particularly American liberal friends, nervous by acknowledging I'm, of course, a theocrat. Jesus is Lord is not my personal opinion. I take it to be a determinative political claim. So I'm ready to rule. The difficulty is that following a crucified Lord entails embodying a politic that cannot resort to coercion and violence. It is a politic of persuasion all the way down, a tiring business that is slow and time-consuming. But then we, that is Christians, believe that by redeeming time, Christ has given us all the time we need to pursue peace. Christ, through the Holy Spirit, bestows upon his disciples the long-suffering patience necessary to resist any politic whose impatience makes coercion and violence the only and inevitable response to conflict. For 1,500 years, Christians thought Jesus' lordship mean they should rule the world. That rule assumed diverse forms, some beneficial and some quite destructive. Constantinianism or Christendom are descriptions of the various ways that Christians sought to determine the cultural and political life of the worlds in which they found themselves. Some Christians look with nostalgia on that past, seeking ways to recapture Christian dominance of the world. That is obviously not my perspective. For as David Hart observes, Christianity's greatest historical triumph was also its most calamitous defeat. The conversion of the Roman Empire, in which it was thought that faith overthrew the powers of this age, found that the faith itself had become subordinated to those very powers. Like Hart, I have no reason to deny the many achievements of Christendom. I think he's right to suggest that the church, however, was a revolution, a slow and persistent revolution, a cosmic sedition, in which the human person was invested with an intrinsic and inviolable dignity by being recognized as God's own creation. But this revolution, exactly because it was so radical, was absorbed and subdued by a society in which nominal baptism became the expression of a church that was reduced to an instrument of temporal power, and the gospel was made captive to the mechanisms of the state. In The Stillborn God, Religion, Politics, and the Modern West, Mark Lilla has written a defense of what he calls the great separation of politics and religion represented by Hobbes. He observes that though Christianity is inescapably political, it has proved incapable of integrating this fact into Christian theology. The problem, according to Lilla, is that to be a Christian means being in the world, including the political world, but somehow not being of it. Such a way of being, Lilla argues, cannot help but produce a false consciousness. Christendom is the institutionalization of that consciousness, just to the extent that the church thought reconciliation could be expressed politically, Little argues. Politics so constituted cannot help but suffer from permanent instability. Lilla, I think, is right that the eschatological character of the Christian faith will challenge the politics of the worlds in which we find ourselves. But that is why, even at times when the church fails to be true to its calling to be a political alternative, God raises up a Karl Barth. For as Barth insisted, this really is all about God, the particular God of Jesus Christ. The humanity of that God, Christians' belief, has made it possible for a people to exist who do, in fact, as Nietzsche suggested, exemplify a slave morality. It is a morality Hart describes as that strange, impractical, altogether unworldly tenderness expressed in the ability to see our sisters and brothers, the autistic or the Down syndrome or the disabled child, a child who is perpetually a perplexity for the world, a child who can cause pain and only fleetingly charm or delight, or the derelict or a broken man or a woman who has wasted their life, or the homeless, the diseased, the mentally ill, the criminals and reprobates as God's people. Such a morality is the matter that is the church. It is the matter that made even the church in Christendom uneasy. From the church's standpoint today, Christendom may be a lamentable world now lost, but it is not now clear what will replace or shape the resulting culture or politics. Hart observes, when Christianity passes from a culture, the resulting remainder may be worse than if Christianity had never existed. Christians took the gods away, and no one will ever believe in them again. Christians demystified the world, robbing good pagans of their reverence and hard-won wisdom derived from the study of human and non-human nature. So once again, Nietzsche was right, that the Christians shaped a world that meant those who would come after Christianity could not avoid nihilism. Why this is the case is perhaps best exemplified by how time is understood. Christians, drawing as they must on God's calling of Israel to be a promised people, cannot help but believe their time has a plot. That is to say, Christians believe, interestingly enough, in history. A strange phrase, to be sure, but one to remind us of how extraordinary it is for Christians to believe we come from a past that will find its fulfillment in the future. Accordingly, we believe that time has a narrative logic, which means time is not just one damn thing after another. The story of creation is meant to remind us that all that exists lends witness to the glory of God, giving history a significance otherwise unavailable. Creation, redemption, reconciliation are names for Christians that we believe constitute the basic plot line that makes history more than a tale told by an idiot. Yet the very assumption that history has a direction is a necessary condition that underwrites the story of modernity earlier characterized by Hart. The story that has underwritten the new atheist presumption that if history is finally rid of Christianity, we will discover that through unconstrained reason, how our politics can be made more just and humane. Thus, Hart speculates that the violence done in the name of humanity, a violence that is now unconstrained, might never have been unleashed if Christianity had not introduced the peculiar variant of apocalyptic yearning into Western culture. Hart rightly observes, such a judgment is purely speculative, given the reality that past great empires prior to Christianity claimed divine warrants for murder. Yet Hart thinks that the secularization of Christian eschatological grammar is the chief cause of the modern state's obvious talent for mass murder. An exaggerated claim, perhaps, but it is at least a reminder that it is no means clear why the killing called war is distinguishable from mass murder. This last observation, I hope, draws us back to Karl Barth's theological work. I suggested Barth exemplifies the politics of speech that is at the heart of the Christian convictions that creates a politics. At the heart of Christian convictions is the belief in the humanity of God, a humanity made unavoidable by our faith in Jesus Christ as the second person of the Trinity. Christ's humanity means no account of the church is possible that does not require a material expression that is rightly understood as a politic. Church matters, matter not only for the church, but we believe what is necessary for the church is a possibility for all that is not the church. I suspect humans always live in times of transition. What is time, if not transition? But I believe we are living in a time when Christendom is actually coming to an end. That is an extraordinary transition whose significance for Christians and non-Christians alike has yet to be understood. But in the very least, it means the church is finally free to be a politic. If I may summarize then what I take to be one appropriate response to this observation, it's quite simply this: for God's sakes, Christians, let's make the most of it. We're free. We're free at last. Thank you very much.